Hey people, before we get started today, I want you to know we're sponsored by LegalZoom. If you're planning your future, LegalZoom is a must. Get real peace of mind and make sure your family is legally protected. For over 12 years, LegalZoom has been helping Americans get personalized wills, powers of attorney, living trusts, real estate documents, and more. LegalZoom also helps start and maintain businesses with incorporation and LLC filings, trademarks, and copyrights. It was built by a team of experienced attorneys, and LegalZoom takes care of you from start to finish with documents that are accepted by courts and government agencies in all 50 states. LegalZoom is not a law firm, but they can connect you to an attorney and provide self-help services at your specific direction. Take advantage of being a WTF listener. Enter Marin in the referral box at checkout for great savings on LegalZoom services. If you're a parent or an entrepreneur, don't wait any longer. Visit LegalZoom.com and protect what's yours. Let's get on with the show.
Lock the gate!
All right, let's do this. How are you, what the fuckers, what the fuck buddies, what the fucking ears, what the fuck nicks, what the fuck tuckians, what the fuckaristas? How's that? I am Mark Maron. This is WTF. We have Rob Schneider today. A lot of things are going on. How many things are going on? I'll be in San Francisco at the Palace of Fine Arts on the 13th. And look, I'm going to tip this because it's time to tip it. If I don't tip it now, it's not going to get tipped. And those of you who checked out of this opening of this monologue because of whatever are not going to know, those people that live in New Jersey, New York City, all its boroughs. I'm doing a secret show. Yeah, you heard me right. Secret show, a free secret show, 10 o'clock, the 14th. That's Sunday, 10 o'clock. In the evening at Union Hall in Brooklyn. All right? It's out there. I'm putting that out there. And then on the 15th, I will be taping my special at Les Poussins Rouges. Les Poissons Rouges. Les Poussins, whatever. It's the old basement of the old Village Gate. Can't wait. A little nervous. Only because I want to be in the zone, man. I want to be in the zone for my special. But not the zone where I know all my material. Fuck that zone. Let's wing it, man. Huh? Why not do a little of that? Let's go old school. Let's go 95 HBO, too much Luna, a little too much weed style special. What's going to happen? I don't know. Wow. Speaking of specials, you know Louis C.K. You know my history with Louis C.K. You know about the Louis C.K. episode of this show. Basically, it's impossible for you to be listening to this show if you don't know who Louis C.K. is. So you're going to want to know that Louis C.K. is ready to premiere an all-new full-length stand-up special on HBO. His first on HBO in over 6 years. It's Louis live at the Celebrity Theater in Phoenix, Arizona, in Louis C.K. Oh, my God. I believe that might be the theater that George Carlin taped in, if I think he told me that. It is his fourth solo stand-up special on HBO, the last one being like January 2007's. Somewhere, yeah, it was 2007, Louis C.K. Shameless. Louis' life and career are both pretty different since that special, so there will be lots to talk about. And I have to say, personally, I think that Louis is at the top of his game, and he's dealing with is a big menu of stuff that you're in store for in this special. The food chain, animals, divorce, murder, morality, mortality, to name a few, that will be covered. There's a brief table of contents. But Louis C.K., Oh My God, debuts this Saturday, April 13th at 10 p.m. on HBO. This is definitely your best bet for a TV fix of Louis while he takes some time off from his FX series. That's Saturday, folks, April 13th at 10 p.m., Louis C.K., Oh My God, only on HBO. That's my friend Louis, so watch that. I'm going to be watching it. I mean, I'm not going to be watching it in real time, but I'm going to TiVo that shit and watch him because I think he's funny. We've been in touch. Every once in a while, people ask me, so that episode with Louis, you guys on top of it? Now, yes, we're doing well. We're friends. I text him frequently when I panic. It's just like the old days. And he makes that panic going, he makes it go away because he's my friend. But look, if just by coincidence you bought tickets to me in San Francisco, Palace of Fine Arts on the 13th, you can TiVo Louis. Enough about Louis. Let's talk more about me. Can we talk more about me? I was in Indianapolis with my friend Ryan Singer featuring me. Ryan featured me. Ryan is here. Ryan came over to eat sausage. Oh, that doesn't sound right. I mean, I made Italian sausage. He came over because I owed him some money, and I made him a sausage. Nice to see you, Ryan. We just had a nice time in Indianapolis. We did 5 shows. They were interesting. They were exciting. How are you?
I'm doing great. Doing great. That was a real fun weekend.
Now, let's just get caught up briefly. Did you go to the mountain today?
Yeah, I did go to the mountain. I had to decompress. I had to reconnect.
But you're always texting me about the mountain. What is this mountain?
Someday I'm going to get you on that mountain.
But what is your relationship with
the mountain? My relationship is the mountain. The mountain makes everything better. You get all clustered in your brain.
Clustered or
I do.
Cluttered?
Both.
You get cluttered?
I get cluttered in my brain. Yeah. I have to go to the mountain. I have to connect with nature. I have to take some deep breaths. I have to clear it all the garbage.
What are you running away from? What is on your phone? What is happening with you?
I got an Instagram account that I dedicated only to my dick. It's a hidden account. I've deleted it.
But this is serious.
I'm addicted to sending dick pics.
But don't you think that at some point perhaps you run for office or you become a big comedy star?
Well, I figure if I flood the market, then it won't be a big deal.
But who do you send dick pics to?
Strangers from Craigslist.
You go on Craigslist and say, what's your number? I got a picture for you.
Well, it's like people who are looking for hookups. They're all bots. So you know it's not really going anywhere.
So you're sending your dick to robots.
Yeah, I'm trying to stop. I haven't done it in a few days.
So you don't even care where the dick pic goes?
No,
it
doesn't matter.
You just want to send it out into the world. What is the feeling like when you release a dick pic?
It feels good. Well, I feel like I can. Well, people say, well, you know, when you send a dick pic to a woman, she's going to show it to her friends. It's like, yeah, that's the point.
Are you that proud of your penis?
No, there's nothing to be that proud of.
But so it's not even.
I think it's part of this exhibitionism past that I used to have when I was younger. So it's kind of starting to bite me in the ass a lot lately.
Well, how's comedy going? I mean,
comedy's going great.
I thought you were funny, man. We had a good time, right?
Yeah, that special is going to be really badass. If you're in New York, you need to go see it.
But that's sold out, but perhaps they go to the secret show. On Sunday night at the Union Hall, Sunday the 14th? That sounds right.
Uh-huh, yeah.
Yeah, the 14th at 10 p.m. for free. I don't know if I'll do the special, but I'll do something. I got to stay engaged, man.
Yeah.
Do you know what
you
I mean?
Were engaged this weekend. Like, there was a lot of just Riff City USA. It was really fun.
I was fucking going out there, dude. Yeah.
Mark did an whole act out where, like, he pretended that the waiter came up and threw a glass of soda
at me. Yeah.
Soda, and then it was a 5-minute piece about how you would have reacted to that and what would have happened to the show after
that. And you told me that the manager of the club came in and thought there was a problem?
Yeah, she walked in mid-piece and thought that somebody really had fucked with you in some big way, and she was freaking out in the back of the room, like, what's going on? Who did what to Mark? And the manager's like, no, listen, no, it's fine. He's just doing a bit. She's like, what happened? Did someone throw something at
him? Yeah.
What's happened? And he's like, no, he's just pretending. Like, you know, because I guess the last time you were there, it wasn't that great of a there might have been some surly moments between you and her. I guess
I don't know. It was all right. I don't remember. It was a long time, but thank you. We had a good time, and this is thank you, Ryan. Thank you for chiming in.
Yeah, no
I appreciate
problem.
It. Good luck with the dick pic thing.
Yeah, well, we're done with that. We're done with the dick pic thing.
And you're done with porn?
Well, I haven't. See, that's the problem. I haven't watched porn since last summer.
So you're okay. So that's done. So now you got to pull back from the dick pics.
I got to pull back from the dick pics.
And maybe you should pull back from taking slightly disturbed women.
Chicks who think I'm a sociopath, don't have them on the road with me?
Yeah, I think that might be a good idea. Hey, speaking of dick pics and things you can do with your dick, AdamandEve.com. You know I push this stuff because I want you to push things inside of you. I want you to wrap things you push inside of other people. Is push a weird word? I think it might be a weird word for this type of thing. But, you know, push, pull, stick, clip, whatever, you know, latex, maybe some things, you know what I'm saying? Make it fun. At Adam and Eve, I'll get you 50% off almost any item, a free bonus gift, 3 free DVDs, free shipping. You go to adamandeve.com, enter WTF at the checkout, and they'll set you up. They'll take care of you. I wish I could offer as a bonus, maybe one of Ryan's dick pics, but, he's not doing that anymore. You're just gonna have to go to adamandeve.com. Enter WTF at the checkout. Get something that'll light up the night, as they said back in the day, based on a song I don't remember. So anyway, we're in there. We're over there at in Indy, and I did Bob and Tom. You do Bob and Tom. Bob and Tom, of course, is an institution. It's a morning radio show that was at one time vital and relevant and exciting and full of fun, and now it's sort of... It's not that it's bad, but they've been doing it a long time. And, you know, it's weird that it seems like a different world. I have a tremendous amount of respect for morning radio crews, and they were certainly one of the best. And now radio is sort of, I know radio is changing because I know that I do advertisements that used to be on radio. And now they're doing podcasts. And some of these cats, you know, I don't want to scare anybody. I want people to keep their jobs. But I'll tell you something. There was a guy over there that he's on the Bob and Tom show. He's sort of the sidekick sports guy. And I've been doing Bob and Tom for years. Not very often, but when I'm in the area, I do it. And Chick McGee, who is on the show, very funny guy, always felt a connection to this guy. Always felt a connection to Chick. Always got a kick out of him. And I knew somewhere in my heart that we were kindred spirits. And now Chick is doing a podcast called Off the Air with Chick McGee. You can get that at chickmcgee.com. And I went on this podcast not knowing that Chick. Not only did I not know that Chick had a co-host, but I didn't know that co-host, Jessica, I believe her name is, was, you know, someone he was in a relationship with, and they are now freshly out of the relationship. And I had no idea about any of this. And I had no idea what I was brought in to do. I mean, I knew I was going to be Marc Maron, but I didn't know that, I would become some sort of, you know, kind of a bridge to their understanding of their relationship by sharing. Look, all I'm saying is that this episode was as loaded emotionally as any episode I've ever done on my show, but it wasn't just me and it wasn't just a guest. I was in the middle of a relationship that had difficulty and had fallen apart. And I had no idea until I was in it. And I can't wait to listen to it because it was one of the most emotional things I dealt with on the air. I almost started crying. So I think you can pick that up and get it on iTunes, Off the Air with Chick McGee, or you go to chickmcgee.com. That should be up today. So I'm curious to hear how that went. But it was heavy, man. I mean, I really didn't know that was going to happen. And I told you about it.
Yeah, and Chick came to the show Saturday night, and he was talking about it in the green room, and you could tell in his face he had been through some shit that day.
Yeah, it was something, man. I also want to say proudly that WTF is now in the Library of Congress. Dig that. You know, I got a guy over there who's a fan, and he's been very interested in comedy. And we've had some conversations about that. He's, you know, my four CDs are in the Library of Congress, but he asked for the first 100 on MP3 DVD, that one that is available still at WTFpod.com. And now we are officially, WTF is officially in the Library of Congress, cataloged the first 100 episodes. And I'm very proud of that. It's posterity. It's, you know, we've been cataloged and archived in the Library of fucking Congress.
For aliens in the future.
Huh?
Aliens in the future will...
Yeah, I always wonder about that whole thing when people go, well, they're going to find this stuff, and what are they going to think? We'll be lucky if there's anything here. You know, let alone speculate about aliens. I think it's just going to be, you know, it's just people, you know, going through things, looking for food and burning things that will burn. Unfortunately, it's not going to be aliens. It's going to be morons.
You don't think they'll have MP3 players as they're scavenging?
No, it's all going to start from the beginning again. It's going to be a new slate. If the aliens... are getting anything from the Library of Congress, I would like to think that they are advanced enough to pick up what I'm doing on iTunes. I have to assume that they're advanced enough to be aliens that they have iTunes. They have access to whatever satellite technology we have, very easily. You know, I don't know what their tech support is or how far along they are with everything, but I have to assume that they've heard my show. So let's get to the guest. Rob Schneider came in and burned off a little steam and talked to me for about an hour. I always liked Rob, and I used to remember his stand-up, and it was a pleasure talking to him. So let's go now to me and Rob Schneider. Thanks for hanging out, Ryan.
Thanks for having me, Mike.
All right, Rob Schneider. Don't say anything else. Rob Schneider now.
I was doing some animated movie. You know, one of these, my friend does an animation company, whatever's the popular movie.
Yeah.
He knocks it off, you know, yeah. Like, or instead of Madagascar, it's called Jungle.
Yeah.
You know, and instead of, you know, Emo or whatever, it's called The Reef, you know, that kind of crap, you know, shark bait or shark bite, you know, whatever's the thing. It's like, instead of like Ice Age, it's, you know, snow, you know, and... but, you know, they make a living, and I do, like, 8 voices, you know. It just rapes me for, you know, different voices.
So your buddy does animation knockoffs? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. It's a Korean company. You know, they just like... No, I'm serious. Yeah, my friend Mark DePay. He's actually a really talented director.
It's sort of like those, you know, when you buy a pinata at one of these Mexican bodega party shops. It's not quite SpongeBob.
No. But you know what's funny, though? It's like, yeah. There's the guys who are kind of... certain corporations are like Nazis, like, you know, yeah. like you would imagine.
Yeah.
Walt Disney.
Sure.
I went into a cake shop and they say, oh yeah, the Disney people are in your cake shop? Yeah. Because, yeah. you know, you could design a Mickey or whatever. And if they say, oh yeah, can you make a Mickey for us? And if you don't, you know, call the company and give them a thing. They got guys out there looking. And
they got stooges or Disney stooges going to cake shops to say, like, hold on.
Can you make that? You know, yeah. and I want a penis cake, but also can you make a Mickey penis cake? And then they go, like, if you don't.
So they got to say, like, wait a minute. Are you from Walt Disney? Or no, it's not called Mickey Mouse. It's called Dickie Mouse.
Yeah, or something. You have to change it.
Did they tell them to pull the cake out of the case and then teach them a lesson?
they fine them or threaten to sue them. And then it's, you know, for people, threat of a lawsuit or a lawsuit is a fine because you have to pay and you have to get a lawyer and blah, blah, blah.
That's the worst thing. Yeah.
And so that's their way. But actually, you know what's funny is that Mickey was supposed to be public domain.
Yeah.
And then they filed a thing with the court saying this.
Steamboat Willie was for everybody?
Yeah. Okay. I mean, pretty much. Sure. But, well, you know, it's only 70 years.
Yeah.
So then, and it was supposed to run out about 12 years ago. And then they got some extension because they're, you know, Disney.
Yeah.
And speaking of which, they just, and so they don't have to, I mean, but in a few years, you can get, they will have to give up on owning Mickey.
Really?
Yeah, they runs out. I mean, it does. It's public domain. They got an extension because they're Disney. You know, I don't even know you can get an extension.
But I mean, wasn't it a Disney product? Didn't Walt create Steamboat Willie?
But it doesn't matter though. Once it's become public domain, that's it.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you know, I mean, Mark Maron, after your relatives at 70 something years, you know, your podcast, you tell them you're not.
It just goes back to the people.
It just, yes, that's where, well, that's the idea of it should be.
Well, yeah, I'm making such a fortune on my likeness now.
Well, it's nice to know that the people will finally get you.
If I find a cake out there that looks like me and the shirt is wrong, I throw a shit fit, man. I get lawyers involved. You motherfuckers can't make Mark Maron cakes.
That's right. And then you got to get them. You got to get your Mark Maron stooges around.
Oh, yeah, you got to have stooges.
You should probably have your Mark Maron stooges podcast stooges, you know, for people. Have taken this forum.
Well, they'd have to. There's a couple they'd have to put out of business. There's a couple.
When were you in San Francisco doing stand up? Because I was there before you, obviously, because I don't remember you there.
No, you were there before me. I'm not sure we've ever met, but we have common friends or common acquaintances. Some of your acquaintances don't necessarily like me, but I was there. I came in. What, second in the competition, I think, 93, maybe? I was there, is that possible?
See, I was there in 80. Okay, the last one that I did of those 90, dumb competitions was 87.
I was there, like, 92 through 94.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, well, that was, like, way past me.
Yeah, I mean, I remember seeing you on TV. I remember, I knew you came from San Francisco. I did my time, you know, on the Alex Bennett show when it was just him talking about his gas.
I know, but he did after a while only talk about, like, the web and, like, you know, what's the internet.
And also, and like, hey, do you feel sick? I feel sick. Does anyone feel a little clammy?
You know, I will say that. Now, Alex, and I like Alex, and I, you know,
sure.
But he was, like, nuts for a while there. Yeah. And, like, literally, the last Arbitron ratings that they did it for him in San Francisco, there was zero listeners.
Well,
there was no one.
In-house studio audience just became one guy who sold pot and a dude wearing a Star Trek uniform.
But that's how great the modern media is now, Mark, is that you can...
In your garage? I think he's on Sirius.
He's on Sirius.
You talk to him still?
Yeah, I'll do his shows, you know, once in a while. And
he probably sounds the same, right?
Yeah, he's doing good. Whatever, you know, drugs he says, he's got a good mix. Whatever he's on, though.
Yeah, he was, like, by the time I got there, you know, his relevance had diminished, and it was just...
give him credit, though. He was huge, though. For a while, he was a kingmaker, kingmaker.
I know, but I miss that. But
I was there, like, I mean, literally, like, Bob Goldthwait was selling out, like... more than just clubs. I mean, he was like an event, and the Goldthwait, and that was single-handedly from the Alex Bennett show. Alex Bennett was, you know, used to do these morning things, and he would pack out a club in the morning.
Yeah, I do it. He still did those. You'd go do to Cobb's, you know, and then Greg Proops would get you high, and then you wouldn't be able to talk.
right.
And he'd just sit there laughing at you because you're too stupid to even function.
I was never
dump pot.
One of those baked comedians. I was never one of those guys who liked.
I wasn't either. That was the problem. Yeah. Like, you know, if Greg Proops like, hey, you want to hang? And I'm like, all right. And then I remember one time he did that to me at a live event at Cobb's, and I literally was so paralyzed with fear and paranoia,
you know,
that I couldn't function.
Well, the weird thing about it is I'll smoke once in a while because my wife likes to smoke, but I don't like to smoke. I just do it out of, you know, defensively to be like, you know, Because otherwise,
all right, I'll do it.
Yeah, yeah. I don't want to be rude, you know, or like, you don't want to be like the square guy.
Yeah.
But like, you know, the couple times you smoked, when I was on Saturday Night Live, there was, you know, Willie Nelson. Okay, well, okay, with Willie Nelson.
You got to smoke with Willie Nelson.
Small room, I'll smoke with him. He seems like a nice guy.
How'd that go?
You know, it was, you know what? He has a surprisingly, not surprisingly, mellow weed.
Yeah.
Like a very mellow high. It wasn't like, you know, spacey crazy. But then I was on stage and I was, you know, one of those things, you know, I was promoting movies.
Yeah.
I kind of got lost in the system. The first time I got kicked out of the studio system, I was depressed when Disney kicked me off. And the second time I got kicked off.
When did that happen?
God, that was like after the Hot Chick didn't open or whatever, you know. It's a good movie, but it wasn't, we opened up against Star Trek. There's a bad idea. No, I know that was my own hubris, my own idiocy. Like, no, I'll go up against Star Trek. What the hell? Come on, I'm playing a girl. What could go wrong? So anyway,
A girl can take on the Enterprise.
So that crashed and burned horribly, and I got kicked. I remember there was a great phone call on Monday after that movie tanked. I got a phone call from Nina Jacobson, the then president, who was then fired about a year later.
From Disney.
From Disney.
Yeah.
Nina Jacobson called up and said, we just want you to know that this does not affect how we feel about you as a movie star, which means this affects how we feel about you as a movie star. And that was it. I was off the lot. You know, in 6 weeks, I was gone.
Really? You had to pack up your bungalow and leave?
Yeah, yeah. I had to pack up my 8 boxes. I actually put my wine cabinet over there. I was such an idiot. You know, I'm going to be here for a while. Really? So anyway, you know, I'm just an idiot having a wine cabinet. You're an idiot.
Wait, what did you have invested in that? Did you wrote and directed it, or was it just a star vehicle?
I mean, I had an actual deal with Disney,
right?
Because, you know, Deuce Bigelow made $350 million.
So yeah,
it's like, you know,
so they're like, this is our guy. He's the golden clown.
He's a guy until he bombs. We're gonna hang on to this guy.
So how does this lead to pot?
And so what happened was, by the time I got kicked off of, then I went to Sony, and then I got kicked off their lot. Now that was it.
What movie was that?
I was relieved.
Which movie was that?
Second Deuce Bigelow. Deuce Bigelow 2, The Abortion. And that's when I took all the studio notes. I didn't used to take all of them before. But anyway, so I'm on stage promoting a movie that I don't like. I'm in some, you know, and you end up being like at the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
And like, you know, when we were kids, if we were at the Super Bowl, we would have like, you know, I was a Joe Montana. I'm a San Francisco guy.
Yeah.
I would have liked, I mean, that Super Bowl was unattainable.
Yeah.
I mean, it wasn't something that.
It's great.
I couldn't even get, I mean, maybe I never went to one game my entire childhood.
Yeah.
It was just not attainable for me.
Yeah,
I'm not a poor kid.
Yeah.
I came from a middle class family. It's just not something they didn't spend money and want to get in that traffic and blah, blah, blah. And it just wasn't attainable for us. So anyway, so here I am. I'm depressed about my movie not doing good. I'm at the Super Bowl. I'm promoting this damn thing. And then I'm on stage and then, Snoop Dogg is like passing out, I thought it was a joint, and it's the next thing I know, it's like it's more like a tube, and it's like a brown tube that's on fire. And I looked at, and I don't know, and I go, at first I thought it was a joint because I know he smoked, but it's just this puff of smoke coming out, and I was all of a sudden this thing, it was like, it's a peace pipe, it's a doggy, you know, Snoop Dogg peace pipe, and then I learned later, it's a spliff.
Yeah, sure.
Which is like a, you know, it's just a real serious joint. And so I said, well, I'm not going to be rude. I'm on stage. You know, he's doing his thing and he's bad. And I don't know what the hell I was doing on stage. So I get a hit of this spliff. And I'm telling you, I was paralyzed for 45 minutes. I couldn't move. I just stood on stage and he kind of like was looking at me. And I didn't even feel like I could move or bounce to the beat or anything. I it was one of those things. It was just before cell phone cameras were able to, because 1,000 people would have had this.
This wasn't the halftime show, was it?
No. This is like one of those shitty parties the night before where people show up or whatever. But this is, thank God, it was before cell phone cameras.
Right.
Where people could, like, videotape. This would be on there forever.
You've just been paralyzed with fear.
Yeah, and then I couldn't move, and I felt like my body was... And then, you know, your knees start to lock up, and you feel like, you know... And then, like, I got to get out of here.
Please tell me Snoop was laughing at you.
After a while, Snoop, he looked over, and then, but he kind of was concerned. And then he realized, yeah, that was some powerful shit. That was the shit I gave him. Yeah.
So when did you were like 12 when you started stand-up?
I was about 15 when I realized there was a comedy club in San Francisco.
Which one?
The Holy City Zoo.
Right, the classic.
And so then I went there.
And who'd you see first, like right away? Steve Pearl?
Who was on stage?
There's a small boy here. I think I'll use him as a phone.
You know what? Who was the guy? Billy Jay was a comedian.
Billy Jay, yeah.
Kevin Meaney.
Yep.
Steven Kravitz was a great guy.
Kravitz, how are you?
Yeah. Steve Pearl.
I hear they're coming out with a turbo Colt. That's all I need is a shitty car that goes really fucking fast.
Hey, and then there is, you know, the first comedian I saw, though, was Gonzo.
Dr. Gonzo.
Yeah, he's a good guy. John Means, we got back in touch. He's out in Illinois working.
Like, he's doing a thing, right? He's got a good thing going. Someone was just talking to me about it.
He's got a theater out there in the middle of...
Bar and restaurant and theater kind of
thing? Yeah, and it's doing well, and he's a great guy.
He was a musical comic.
Yeah, he's one of those guys, but the musical comic you respected.
Right. He was one of those guys,
because, you know, most of the music, I mean, like...
He had integrity. He was
song parodies is just, you know, it's like... Yeah. On Saturday Night Live, the lowest form of comedy was a shit joke or a celebrity screaming. Or a celebrity or somebody screaming or a shit joke. And actually, Phil Hartman in 1992 was able to combine a Rob Smigel joke to make the trifecta of hackiness, a celebrity screaming a shit joke, which was, I got, like doing a Frank Sinatra impersonal, I got chunks of guys like you in my stool. So there's a celebrity yelling a shit joke right there. So you got the...
This was an intentional challenge that he took.
Yeah, but Rob Smigel is one of those... He's a genius. A comedy genius.
Absolutely.
But could not differentiate between his stuff that was just good and stuff that was brilliant. He loved it all.
So, okay, so it's Billy Jay, Dr. Gonzo, Kevin Meaney. Did you know Stephen Pearl? Because he was...
Steve,
he was sort of a wizard. Kravitz and...
Kravitz and Warren Thomas.
Warren Thomas.
He was a lovely guy. I could say Warren was much, much, much funnier off stage than on stage.
Yeah, because he just had no boundaries and you just immediately became a sponge for
his
humor.
But he also had some demons, obviously.
Oh, yeah.
I remember hanging out with him and he was, you know, doing all kinds of stuff. We would stay up till 7 o'clock in the morning.
Right.
And he was doing blow and we would just, but he would still be one of those guys who was like funny, not like get paranoid on. He would just make jokes. We're watching TV, constantly making jokes on everything.
Yeah, yeah.
And after a while, you can't laugh anymore. All I was able to do was just go, I was just like, just to vocalize that, yes, that's a joke, I recognize
it. Yeah, he was fast. He was so fast.
Yeah, but never disciplined enough to be on stage to where he could craft and act and build on it. And that's what you need to do to be successful. He'd have brilliant sets sometimes,
right.
But it was just he would go up and down. But he wasn't able to, like... To craft something in a way that, like, you know, which is what you have to do.
I don't think he liked repeating things. He was one of those guys where he's like, I don't want to do my act. And then, like, by default, he'd end up doing it. But it was always seemed like he wasn't planned. Like, he'd have good bits.
Well, you know, what he had was an incredible likability. But even that, though, was only going to get you so far.
And he was also a riff style. You know, there was that kind of like Warren Thomas, Steve Pearl, Robin Williams, and then Craig Proops, Matrix.
Robin was the reason we had a scene at the time, because, you know, audiences were showing up to see him, and more times than not, they would, because he was one of those guys that just couldn't help it, and he's dying to get on stage.
He's on stage right now somewhere, no matter where he is.
Yeah, I know. As a matter of fact, I had not performed up in San Francisco, and I performed up there.
The Throckmorton? The Throckmorton?
It was the Mark Pittas place.
Throckmorton Theater.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
That is like, you know, it's like a senior center with seats.
Yeah, you go
you know?
There, yeah.
It's like, I mean...
Backstage and in the audience.
And I saw Mart Saul. I saw what was left of Mart Saul backstage.
Yeah. He's still saying, I invented everything.
Yeah.
I said that once.
but it was still great to see him. But, you know, it's funny. He shows up, but then he doesn't leave the back room. He doesn't go see the show.
No,
That's a perfect comic. That's a comic.
Yeah. Well, he doesn't... Like, I've asked him to interview. Like, he's got some weird beef with me or something. I think he's one of those guys that thinks that he invented, you know, writing and paper. And...
Yeah. You know, but there's some of the guys... You know, one thing I've noticed, Mark...
Doug Ferrari's back around.
Is he really... Oh my God. Well, Doug Ferrari was another guy who used to murder, and I go, how is this guy? Doug Ferrari is a guy who used to sing song parodies for people out there.
Yeah.
He was murdering so hard, and I brought a girl who was with me at the time, you know, I was, you know, a hound, and I was this girl who was a dancer, and she was just nuts, but I was just totally into her. She was laughing so hard at him, I broke up with her. I swear to God, I said, that's it. I can't.
When did you first go on stage?
No, so I was 15. I walked to the, you know, I had my dad, and was this lovely guy, Marvin, a nice Jewish guy from San Francisco, Marvin Schneider. And he, and I said, Dad.
Still around?
No, he's passed away.
Hmm.
So I said, you know, hey, Dad, there's a club, the Holy City Zoo. And I said, on Monday nights, they let anybody go up there. And he said, let's go.
Yeah.
So it was it. You know, I had a trombone, as I tell, you know, play trombone between jokes.
You did?
And it was just weird, you know, because when you're a kid up there.
Did you have a trombone?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And so when you're a kid, You know, it's like, it's you have to be, the audience has to be in a, like, you know how baked I was with Snoop? There was a kind of, there was an ambiance happening. Yeah. There was like a, you have to have that so the audience can be relaxed and they can settle into you. There's like a mood that has to happen. Yeah. When you see a kid up there, your audience just stiffens up and go, no. And then, you know, I don't know what the hell to talk about that's going to be relatable to these people. You know, they're not going to laugh at my
Why the trombone? Science teacher jokes.
Because I thought, hey, I could do it between jokes.
So, but it was an earnest thing?
Between jokes. And I swear to God, that's what I did. I only did it one time and I realized the waste of this. But then I remember thinking,
it must have been as big as you were, the fucking horn.
But here's the best part of it. You know, then I started going, anytime I was 15, I had a car.
Yeah.
I, you know, because I was working. I was like a, I worked for Chang and Chow 76 in San Francisco.
Yeah.
John Chang and Patrick Chow. And they had a
76 station?
76 station.
What were you doing?
No, I was pumping gas because that was when they used to pay cash a lot of times, you know. And I was the only guy. I didn't steal from them. So they loved me. Yeah. They used to tell me, I said, oh, Rob, why don't you call? Why you want to finish school for? You work here full time. No, you work here full time. No, quit that job, that school stuff. No, you work here. That's it. No more. And I went, you know, but I kind of like, I want to do other things. No, why do other things? No, I can't. Because they knew that they could add the bill and it was even, you know, right, when I was working. So, no, you stay here, work full time. That's it. And they just, you know, I wanted to do other things, but they were lovely people, but they also, the only time that they, you know, that I, you know, I'm just one of those things, I just will not steal. I just have that thing about that, you know. I mean, I'll take a pen, you know, pens I got, I will steal.
Sure.
I'll steal your fucking pen before the end of the day. But the, so anyway, the only thing so people, they would come in, and the only thing ever, the bad thing I ever did was they would make me change brakes. Like, you know, if somebody came in, you just needed to adjust it. No, change it.
Yeah.
And I go, but it looks fine. No. They want new brake, you give them new brake. You know, you got the customer all the way right.
So, you knew how to change brakes?
That's about the only, you know, I can fix anything on a Volkswagen because that's what I had.
Yeah.
But the, so anyway, I started being able to get around and I was able to get to that club when I was, you know, 16, especially 16, hitting that club. And then, and I remember, like, the club owner, I forget the guy's name who was running the place.
Samuels? Somebody?
Samuels? Oh, no, you mean Jim Samuels?
Yeah, was it Jim?
Well, Jim, he was the comic. He was, like, the guy who won the comedy competition in 82. He was a super nice guy.
But he didn't own the club?
No, he didn't own the club, but he was such a great guy.
Yeah.
I mean, that's why it's like, you know, when I grew up, you know, gay people were like, you know, my heroes because they were such lovely people. And Jim was one of them, who was just this lovely, lovely, great, generous comedian. Anyway, so.
And San Francisco it was like celebrated in San Francisco.
Yeah. You know, I mean, it was, well, you know, we also had like the first openly gay, you know, city council.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, Harvey Milk. And,
yeah.
And I was in school when he was killed.
You remember that day?
Yeah, that was just like, I just remember because being in class and I just heard like, I heard that the mayor got killed, but I didn't know that it was also Harvey Milk who got killed. And I remember.
That must have been crazy day.
Yeah, man. Well, that was just, you know, one of the weird things because it's not like today, a school shooting, it's just like, you know, what else is on the news? It's like page four.
This was, yeah, it didn't happen. That kind of shit just didn't happen.
Yeah, so that was really a trippy, bizarre thing. And then, you know, because it was the beginning of, you know, for, you know, I mean, if you take like, you know, if you take gay and put Negro in the switch words, it's the same fight as it was in the 60s.
Right.
You know, and, you know, it's for just equality and rights and stuff. So, but being there. So, that really made San Francisco an interesting, great place, I thought. And so, you know, when I was 16 and I don't remember going. So I went to the club and the guy said, okay, you can perform and you can be on stage, but you're underage. You can't have liquor there. So you have to get out of here. You can only perform. You got to wait outside. You can't hang out in the club.
So you're standing outside.
So I'm standing outside, and then I go on stage, and I did my 5 minutes. And by this time, I've been done it for, you know, a few times.
Yeah.
Just like my third or fourth time. And then after I perform, you know, I got a couple laughs. And then Billy Jay, of course, this comedian. Hey, what are you doing? Come back here, kid. Come sit in the back. You can watch in the back. So I go, okay, come sit in the back. Anyway, so I'm watching for a bit. The guy sees me, grabs me by the nape of the neck and lifts me, my toes dragging out of the club and dumps me onto the bar. I'm going to say, hey, what did I tell you, kid? I know, but Billy Jay, are you going to listen to me or him? You know? So anyway.
There was a couple jokes he used to do that were, that I remember pretty well that were hilarious. You know, why don't you, the Rolling Stones joke. Well, why don't you go down there and sit in with the band? That joke.
Oh, yeah, yeah. That was like
a great joke.
Well, thank you.
Your clarinet.
Yeah, gosh, that's funny. You know, why don't you just, take your clarinet, go sit with the band. Sit in with the band. That, you know, my dad's idea of like, you know, just go and join in there, you know? I'm sure they just show up. Well, because my dad was played jazz music in the 40s.
What was his instrument?
He played everything. He played any woodwind instrument. Then he can, you know, figure out the piano, whatever. He played about 17 instruments, you know.
Uh-huh.
And he could play any woodwind instrument, sax or whatever. So when a band would show up,
yeah.
he'd bring his clarinet and say he's with the band and sneak in. So my dad was like, when the Stones were in town, yeah. Hey, just bring your clarinet and see if you can, you know, sneak in and say, hey, I'm with the band. Yeah, you know, I'm the clarinet player. I'm playing the bassoons. You know, come on, sticky fingers, come on. I'm the clarinet, the guy, the clarinet. Satisfaction, that's me. That's the great thing about having parents who are older. Hopefully, my daughter will feel the same way.
Well, how old were they when they had you?
Well, I was the last one. I was the accident, though. My parents were like mid-30s.
How many brothers and sisters do you have?
I got two brothers and three sisters.
You just had a kid.
You're my age.
You're a month older than me, I think. You're 49?
Yeah, 49, baby.
Because I got a girl now, wants a kid. How old's your girl?
My wife's 20 years younger than me, which is great.
Yeah, that's the same with me, man.
She still wants to do things, leave the house, have friends.
How's that going?
Learn how to read, all this stupid shit that's unnecessary. No, I said, I'll read it to you, honey. Well, how's it going? It's going, except that, you know, she's got a lot more energy. And here's the deal. Part of the machismo for being a guy is like, you know, I can't admit when I'm tired.
Right,
you know?
Right.
It's like, you know, when you're in your 20s, the difference is going out with the girl, hey, you know, I want to throw you down and take you and then, you know, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah,
you know?
sure.
And in your 40s, it's like, well, let me give a couple more hours before this thing kicks in, baby. You know?
Yeah. About 40 minutes.
So but I know what I want. Yeah. And I also, you become more patient. And then it's a weird thing that happens because my wife is a really bright girl, but she talks about, like, you're having andropause.
Yeah.
Andropause?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, supposedly it's the same thing like menopause, except andropause. It's like, it's this bullshit
stuff. She read something.
Yeah, but it's this bullshit thing where they have to, everything in America has to be a disease. By the way, did you notice that 65% of every commercial on TV right now?
Yeah.
Is a fucking drug commercial.
Yeah.
It's a drug commercial because we took a drugged out country. You know, it's so funny.
And also our procedural commercials with weird vaginal, there's lube commercials now, there's vibrator commercials now,
But most of it's drugs.
Something
you watch the news, every commercial's on there.
Sure.
It's a drug.
Sure.
So anyway, but
go
it's going
sleep.
Good. But so she says basically, and the idea is as you get older in your 40s, your late 40s, your hemispheres of the separating two sides of the brain starts to melt.
Is that true?
Yeah.
Is it?
So you become more emotional. You think about seeing Cinema Paradiso.
Again,
yeah. And you, so it becomes, you become less of, it happens at the same time that your testosterone is, you know, diminishing.
So you're slowly becoming an old woman? Is that?
Yeah, I mean, I am. I'm becoming the, I'm definitely the woman in the relationship, but I'm also okay with it.
Yeah.
That's the thing about the, you know, getting older. You have to become more tolerant or you fucking die.
How's the baby? How old is this baby?
This baby is 3 months old.
Oh my God.
3 months and 3 days.
I
count the days.
Yeah.
That's how beautiful. And really, it's beautiful. Like this morning, I was up with her at 5. My wife always says, you don't do enough. I do everything.
Yeah.
And I said, I just changed how many diapers did you change today? I said 2. I did 10. You know, so, but I don't have, you know, I don't have tits. I can't feed the baby.
Yeah.
And you're better and you're younger, you know?
Yeah.
But again, it's a machismo. I can't admit that I'm younger and I get tired. I mean, that she's older and I get more tired.
So you got up with the kid at 5?
Yeah. I was up at 5:30. And what happens is, you know, it's the mom is staying with us. Thank God the abuelita's there.
Yeah.
Abuelita, that's Spanish for free domestic servant, you know. So she's the grandma's staying there. She's like the baby whisperer. Cuz the baby could be crying, pooping, sneezing or you know, usually all those things at the same time. And then she just comes over and she's got a whistle and a shush. It's like a shush shush shush. The baby's like, ah! She's like, the baby's like, you know, baby, you know, she does the same thing at customs, too. You know? Yeah, ma'am, I noticed you don't have a visa to enter America. Ma'am, you have a live chicken in your luggage. But I would definitely recommend it.
Yeah.
It'll throw your life in turmoil. I mean, I definitely feel like I've aged 2 years in the last 3 months. But that's okay, you know. I love it, and it's just, you know, it really is. So it's exhausting. And just when you think, God, we have to kill it, you know, it starts smiling at you, you know. And then our window to kill it is closed, you know.
What did your parents do when you grew up?
My dad was in like real estate and had like a little loan business. This was before.
And
this
he was
like,
a musician too.
Yeah, and he was a musician, but he knew it as a musician, he wasn't going to be able to make enough money, bread, to like, you know.
Yeah.
To pay for a family.
Yeah.
So he knew he'd.
And he was a Jew.
Yeah. So he was like, he's the only Jew that, but there was like different kinds of Jews though who would like,
I know,
you know,
I'm a Jew. I'm a certain kind.
But there's different, you know, just like in every, you know, class
yeah,
structure.
Yeah, sure.
He was like, my grandfather couldn't read or write.
Right.
He was a barber.
Uh-huh.
He had his, a barber shop next to the Fox Theater. On Market Street in San Francisco.
Really?
The old Fox Theater.
Uh-huh.
And my dad used to shine shoes, you know, and my dad was telling me, like, you know, they used to have stickers.
Yeah.
Where they had stickers and you could, you know, during the war,
yeah.
World War II, the soldiers would come in and yeah. they'd get a haircut and whatever, and then he'd, you know, give them a facial for like another nickel.
Yeah.
And then my dad would sign the shoes for another couple of pennies.
Yeah.
And then if they wanted to spend a dime, they could win a bicycle.
Uh-huh.
And the bicycle was like, you peel back these things and it come, Schwinn would sell these things and, you know, and then the company would make a little bit of money and give a bicycle. But my grandfather did, he pulled off all the things, took the bike,
yeah.
gave it to Marvin,
yeah.
and then put the things back on so people had no chance of winning. Of course, my dad, you know, he was...
he got the bike,
he got
though.
The scam, you know, yeah. he was scamming the... So, but...
But you didn't scam the Changs.
I never scammed them Changs. Them damn Changs never got scammed by me. But Sam, yeah, growing up there was just you had at your disposal. But at the same time, wherever you grew up, I think is really boring.
Wait, your mom was Filipino?
My mom's Filipino. So we had like my mom had great timing. She would never understand any jokes. She would just be like, ha ha ha, would she laugh at them? Ha ha ha. And then she'd lean over and go, what does it mean?
So she was being polite.
She was being polite, yeah.
Yeah. But you're saying it was boring no matter where you grew up?
Well, wherever you grow up, it seems like this is boring. I remember driving around San Francisco with my dad, and I go, what's that big building? And he said, it's a hotel. And I went, people pay money to come here? This is awful. But then, you know, when you get older and you're 15, you realize, you know, I found out, yeah, Sam, you know, Chinatown, I have this old map. I don't know where the hell it is, but it's a map from 1874 of Chinatown. And it's a map that's from the police station that marked out all the opium dens because they were legal. Opium dens and then the white, with the Chinese prostitution and white prostitution.
Really?
Okay, yeah. So the whole thing was red, which means it's the whole thing was an opium den.
Yeah.
And there was like yellow, which means it was all Chinese prostitution everywhere and a couple little white things. So for the guys, you know, you get bored. You go, you know, I'm tired of these Chinese prostitutes. They got any whiteies around here, you know? I feel like a little...
For the sailors.
Yeah, yeah. Go, let's mix it up a little bit, you know what I mean? And then I've got a couple of those lamps. My wife made me throw away all my antiques, unfortunately. She said, the only antique I like is you. So, but I had a couple of those old lamps from the old, you know...
Yeah.
Because, you know, San Francisco, they had some of those old antique places. There was used to be a place on Grant Street called Old Vogue or whatever it was.
Right.
Or like there was
some of those antique places are ripoffs. They're fake antiques.
Some of them. But these guys, I believe, like this is one of these old, like, you know, and it was basically
a gas
lamps.
Lamp?
A lamp, yeah. There was like a little lamp with as an alcohol lamp.
Oh, right,
that
they'd
go around. And then the guys would, you know, take their pipes and smoke off it while they're sitting there getting baked, thinking about whoring.
Yeah.
And so I said, wow,
well,
San
I think
Francisco.
It was probably one or the other. Yeah, I mean, in my knowledge of opiates, there's not much fucking going on.
That's true. Okay.
That is the fucking.
That is true. Okay. Yeah, you're right. So, but that was a great place.
Well, I mean, don't get mad about it.
But the
But wait, let's track the career for a minute, can we? Because I want to. So you start doing it when you're 16.
Yeah, and then I got to buy. When I found out, by the time I was 20, and I got to like.
But you were sort of a prodigy in a way. I mean, you know, people liked you. You did the little, they called you Little Elvis, right?
Yeah, I mean, I got, by 19, by 20, I was hitting it. And I was 21. I got the old other cafe. That was the blessing for us, was that cafe, which was run by fake hippies.
Yeah.
They would pretend to be your friend and pretend to be giving you a good deal and then steal from you. And they liked me because I would be MC.
That was in the East Bay?
No.
The other cafe?
The other cafe was right in Carl and Cole in the Haight-Ashbury,
San Francisco. Okay.
And that was the place. And like the headliner at the time there was Dana Carvey. That was the guy. And I opened for him. And he had a real audience. They were jazzed. They would line up around the block to see him.
Well, he sort of like came from street performing, didn't he?
He was the biggest guy. No, he was,
I'm thinking A. Whitney Brown.
A. Whitney Brown, yeah. Well, he did more than street performing. That guy did time. That guy did, you know, that guy did prison performing. Yeah,
he's a character, dude.
Yeah, that's the only guy that I'd never had a conversation with when he was on Saturday Night Live, because I knew he was an evil guy from being in San Francisco.
But he's a very
when he was on Saturday Night Live, he got in Dennis Miller's head and he said, "Hey, Dennis, Let's go watch you. And he'd watch the tape. Dennis Miller, well, you know, A. Whitney Brown was watching a tape with Dennis Miller, yeah. and Whitney was just going, look at you. Look at the fear. It's nothing but fear. You got nothing. I mean, I'm telling you, this isn't working. Look at that. You're crumbling here. And he was like, and Dennis was just destroyed. And went like, and then he realized, hey, this is an evil guy trying to ruin me. I let this guy into my house. It's like letting the devil into your house. Anyway, so he would try to get into everybody's head, you know, and then, you know.
Well, it taught you an important lesson, not to let people in your head.
Yeah. So whenever he would even try to have a conversation with me, he would, like, the weirdest thing about him was he'd try to have a conversation with me. I don't know why we're talking about A. Whitney Brown. He would have a conversation with you, and I would just turn around and walk away. Yeah. I would never even engage. And he would have a really, try to quick way to get in your head, like, I heard you sucked at blah, blah, and that was that walk. I'd go, you know, I wouldn't even get to the end. That one sketch, you stunk, and that was it.
All right, so wait, okay, so here you are. You're at the other cafe.
Yeah.
Yeah, and Dana Carvey's the big deal. And that was a music venue too?
Or
was
it all? No. It was like a coffee shop, little restaurant run by fake hippies.
Yeah.
And they got rich off this place because people would show up and they'd pay like $10-$12 on Friday,
right.
Saturday.
Right.
Which was like ridiculous.
Right.
Know? And then we would, you know, then there'd be people would come in. Jerry Seinfeld would play that place. And it was like, it was one of the hipper places in the whole country.
What year was this, man?
This is 84.
Yeah.
You know?
Okay.
So you're talking, you know, you're literally 84, 85, 86. That was the gold standard there for San Francisco comedy at that time.
Right.
I mean, it really was. I mean, they could say 82, 83 other comedians, but for me, that was the time where it was an explosion of comedy.
And you were featuring or you could headline?
Yeah, no. I was basically an MC, which I was happy to do it because, well, the best thing about for me was I could MC and then, which, you know, and introduce all the comics all night. And they liked, the club liked me, the fake hippies liked me because I could keep the audience there.
Because you didn't steal.
And I'd be drinking. And I never stole, yes. No, trust me. Why you want to do that? There's no, don't go back to school. No, you stay here. You got a future here. I'm pump number three. You got a future. Thanks, Chang.
So you hosted, and then when did the break come? How'd that happen?
Well, it's one of those things where, like, you know, I had a really, you know, nice manager. You know, Tom Fisher was a guy, a nice guy. He was a comedy club.
He didn't own the zoo?
No, he didn't own the zoo, but he booked a bunch of places, and he was really super nice to me. Had a heroin problem.
Sure.
But never, he seemed to have it kind of under control. And, you know, but San Francisco, you know, that's one of the things, you know, I want to manage you, but I got a heroin problem. Okay, all right. You know, I'll be available Tuesdays and Thursdays between 8 and 9 at night. I'll sober up. But, so this guy, and he used to get me some gigs, like 25 bucks. So you'd go to a place, get 25
go
bucks.
Go to Stockton.
50. Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah. You go to Reno.
Yeah.
And then,
what about the John Foxes of the world?
Yeah, well, and then I was the MC for a while I was the MC at the Punchline, which was great. And you could actually make a few hundred bucks doing that.
Did you meet Bill Graham?
Yeah, Bill Graham actually saw me. It's funny. Bill Graham saw me and said, hey, you're a funny kid. And I started to get hot about 1985. You know? Said, hey, you're a funny kid. You know what? 85, 86. That's when.
Yeah.
And he said, they got these bands coming in from England.
Yeah.
You're going to open for them. You're young. You're hip. They're going to like you. And I went like, okay. Cut to, I'm opening for this band called, you know, their big hit was, you spin me round and round, baby, round and round like a record, baby. And they're like really hardcore. Everyone's dressed black. They have their hair dyed black. And they got like, you know, and they're pale. It was like, and I literally, I'm on stage trying to tell a joke. A quarter flies right towards me, hits me right above the eye. Good night. And then a bottle. And I said, whoa, that was it. You know, and then they said, kid, it's not working out. And then, I know, but he still had me open, you know, working middling. I think started middling at that time in a for his Punchline.
Yeah,
because he owned the Punchline at the time.
Yeah, yeah.
But he was great, you know. I mean, he was one of the guys who was, you know, kid. You know, you're gonna be huge. I'm never wrong. You know, it's one of those things. It's like, really, am I? But in '84, what really helped me a lot was. 84, like maybe it was 85, like 85, 86, about that.
Yeah.
But Jay Leno was like, you know, he was on Letterman doing like, where's the beef?
Yeah.
You know, what's your beef? You know, Jay, what's your beef? I'll tell you my beef, Dave. Hey, Dave, let me tell you my beef. You know my beef? You know what I'm saying? Here's the thing. You know these guys, you know, you got these cars, you know the old cars, like 1950s? You know these cars, you know, it's got a grill, you know, it's got a grill, you know, you in the morning you get up and, you know, you hose off a Toyota Celica, you know, one of these kind of grills, you know what I mean? That's a real real car. This is a car. Not a Toyota. This is a real car. And so he was doing that kind of stuff. And he got huge. He's, all of a sudden, he started
playing
theaters.
Yeah.
And so
he was a funny comedian.
Oh, he was a great comic. He was the strongest comic. You know how, like, you have your killer bits when you first start? Okay.
Yeah.
5 minutes from now, we're going to get to that killer bit. I'll just get through this weak section. Then I'll get to the kill, and then I'll space it out, and then I'll get to the killer bit at the end, and then I'll be okay.
Yeah. Filler. It's all filler.
Every bit of his was a killer bit. Yeah. It was a monster bit.
Yeah.
And then in 85, you know, he was absolutely the strongest, best comedian in the country by far. He was the best comic of his era. So anyway, so he, my manager said, hey, listen, you know, he got booked and, you know, he like helped book him or something in these theaters.
Fisher.
Yeah. And so you pick him up and just hang out with him. You can absorb something from him.
Yeah,
you know?
You're the opener. You go get the guy at the airport.
You know, but I didn't open. I wasn't even the first. And then I opened for him after that. But what happened was you pick him up. Just make sure you're on time and make sure you know where you're going. I know you know the city because I'm like a city rat.
Yeah.
I know anything.
Yeah.
And so I'd be right there, right at the gate.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, where's your car? I go, it's right up front, Mr. Leno. And so we go out in the car, and then after a while, you go, hey, kid, you know, you're a comic? What do you need? yeah, I'm a comic. Well, how long have you been doing it? I said, here's what happened was I think the second time I drove him, he said, well, you know a good Chinese restaurant? You from here? You know what I mean? I go, yeah. He said, you know a good Chinese restaurant? I said, I know the best, Mr. Leno. And he said, you know, it's open right now? I said, absolutely, right now in Chinatown. I took him over to the Sam Woe's, and I took him, and I said, you know, and I said, he's going to want to go to a fancy place. I took him over to Grant Street, and I said, there's a place that's where they bring the president, eats there. President Carter. There's a picture of President Carter up there.
What place was that?
So that was on Grant Street. I forget the name, but second story Grant Street. So I took him there.
Yeah.
And he was happy.
Yeah.
It was a good restaurant. Yeah. I'm not some schmuck thinking him, some dive place. So I'm sure he's used to by that time. And so I said, hey, okay, come in. I'll buy you lunch. You drive me around. You know where the radio stations were. It's good. And so he said, so how long are you comic? It's finally, that came out 3 hours later.
Yeah.
You comic? Yeah. How long have you been doing? I said, maybe 8 months, 10 months. And I said, yeah, okay, listen, all you need is just get 5 minutes that kills everywhere. You don't have that, you don't have anything. All these comedians say, I got 2 hours. Who wants to hear 2 hours of material? I don't want to. So just get 5 minutes that kills everywhere. If you don't have that, you don't have anything. All you need in LA is 20 minutes to become a star. So truth be told, I got 5 minutes that killed. Mm. And what I did was if even comedians were talking about the same subject, I take it out. And I said, I knew I was getting somewhere when I was taking stuff out that was working.
Right.
But it just wasn't murdering.
Right.
And it wasn't as keenly individual for me. Anyway, that 5 minutes, 6 months later, that 5 minutes I did on the Letterman show,
Before the Young Comedian?
Well, actually, no. I got on the Young Comedian special.
Who got you that?
The Young Comedian, that was 89. Jeez, this is like, but between 86 and 89, that's like when you're a kid.
Yeah.
That's like 10 years.
Right.
You know, it's the theory of relativity. Right now, it's like, 3 years ago for us is like a dump.
Yeah.
A long dump.
Yeah.
And for, when you're a kid, 3 years, that's like a gigantic amount of your career. So by that time, I was ready to hit it. But I never had more than 25 minutes of killer material.
Ever.
At that time. Now I do. I mean, I was always envious those guys had a monster hour.
Well, you were one of those guys that somehow avoided the sort of the kind of road headlining for years.
Yeah, I mean, comedians in the middle acts were making more money in 1986, 87, 88.
Yeah.
Especially 88 when when the comedy clubs started blowing up all over the country.
Right.
88, 89. As a middle act, you can make $1,500, sometimes $1,750.
To go out, just
in a middle act.
Yeah.
And you can make a living. And now it's $100 a show for guys.
Yeah, it's crazy. The middle acts.
Yeah, so they're just eating it.
It doesn't even exist anymore.
Even the headliners are making like $800 a week. Unless you're like a TV, known guy, it's tough,
Yeah. And so, okay, so the first thing you got was Young Comedians, or you did Letterman before that?
I did Letterman in 87.
In New York. They flew you out to New York.
The next day, I had to move to L.A. because I got an agent.
After Letterman.
And so I got an audition to be for a movie. It sounded good because Charles Grodin was in it, and Dan Aykroyd, and Jim Belushi. And it turned out to be like a piece of crap called The Couch Trip. But at the time, it's like a movie. Are you kidding? I never auditioned for a movie. You know? So, okay, so I drive down to L.A. On the way down to L.A., I crash my car. I literally, it was an old, I had an old, you know, what the hell was the car? You know, it was Ralph Nader's Unsafe at Any Speed.
Pinto
Corvair.
A Corvair? But the hell did you get a Corvair?
You know, it was just some, you know, it was just a cool, you want to have a cool old car for the chicks,
it's
you know.
It's a weird car.
And it didn't even have seatbelts, a 1960 Corvair. Luckily, yeah. It was really muddy, yeah. So it just slid. And I remember, I wasn't even scared. I was upside down. I was like, I'm going to be okay. I'm going to be. It flipped, you know, like, you know.
Where? Like in Big Sur? Where
I
the hell?
Just filled up on I-5 right below the 156. You make a right, and it was just, I just filled up a tank, which means the back was heavy.
Yeah.
And the engine's in the back. So, it means, you know, you're basically, you're doing a two-wheeling.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And then I started, anyway, a tumbleweed, and I literally just tried to turn like a half an inch, and the next thing I was fishtailing, exactly what Ralph Nader, I just saw Ralph Nader in my head, what were you thinking? Well, I figured, you know, maybe this car's safe because it survived, and it's like, no, people used to have to put sandbags in the front.
Of a Corvair.
To weigh it down so it wouldn't spin out like this, and I, of course, I'm an idiot, and I'm like 20, and so I'm upside down on the, like a cat clinging to the carpet. With my fingernails,
yeah.
And it just slid to a stop. And I remember I didn't get, like, I didn't think much about it. I dinged my shoulder a little bit.
Yeah.
And then I climbed out, and then I had to literally climb out and roll down the window. And then this truck driver said, I can't believe you walked out of that one. And I went, really? He says, yeah, man, I see this all the time. No, dead people do that stuff. Went, whoa. He said, no, if it wasn't for mud, you'd be messed up right now.
Yeah.
So anyways, holy shit.
So did he drive you to your audition?
So here's what happened. Funny you say that, though. I had no credit cards because I had no credit.
Right.
You know, you didn't have to have credit or insurance back then. This is the, you know, the 80s, the good times.
Yeah.
And so I didn't have credit cards. So I thought, okay, well, how am I going to get to L.A.? I got an audition, blah, blah, blah. You know, it's early in the morning. And so I go to this. I call all these places and I say, can I get to rent a car? Sure, we got cars. I don't have a credit card. Click.
Yeah.
I don't know. Can I rent a car? Sure, you're going to rent a car. I don't have a credit card. Click. I call. So, hey, listen, I don't have a credit card. I don't mind. Come on over. You know,
come on.
This is in Los Banos.
Okay.
So this guy, it turned out this guy, I swear to God,
yeah.
It was a carpet place.
Yeah.
He sold carpets. He rented a few cars on his lawn, and he had fish tanks. So anyway, and I said, you know, and he said, well, I said, how much is the car?
Yeah.
How much you got?
Yeah.
And I said, I got like $200. It's $200. And I like, okay, you know, all right, here we go.
And he sold you the car.
He made, no, $200, and then you got to bring it back. And I said, when you, he said, I said, when do I need to bring it back? When are you coming back up this way? And I was like, well, you know, probably, you know, a week, I don't know. He said, that's good to me. So anyway, I get in this car. It was a Ford Granada that was just basically almost as unsafe as the car I was just in. And it was just so old. It was like a 75, it was literally 75 Ford Granada. I know because my dad used to have, it was like a 77 Ford Granada.
Yeah.
You know, that was like a, you know, so anyway, I drive down to the place, and I drive down, and then I'm like, and it's a piece of crap. And then here's the thing is, it's January.
Yeah.
You know, and then it's, so in San Francisco, it's cold.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So in LA,
it's hot. Yeah.
So I've got like, you know, my black tight, you know, black jeans, black boots I used to wear, and I had like my black leather jacket with a black sweater. I'm San Francisco, you know, I don't know what I was, but like, you know, anyway, and you know what I was in LA? Sweaty. What?
Yeah.
And it's hot.
Yeah.
Anyway, so I go to this audition, I drive down there, you know, I'm late because, you know, it's a guy by the time, you know, the crash.
Did you tell him the story when you got there?
No, I was just like, you know, she did say this to me. Do you want to practice it? And I went, no, let's just read it. I never, you know, so I start reading it. And then I noticed that the smile she had, she didn't have anymore.
Yeah.
She said this to me, have you ever acted before? I went, yeah, sure, why not? So anyway, after that, this is before cell phones, I get on that, and my heroin manager said, listen, dude, I got to figure out how to act down here, because they seem to value that. So I'm in my car, and I'm driving, I think I just fucked up my first audition.
Yeah.
I'm driving, I'm looking up at these billboards of these movie stars, you know, and these movies, and I go, holy crap, you know, I think, and I'm looking up, and I hit a pedestrian.
No, you did not.
I did, I hit a pedestrian. I was like, it was a stop sign, but I rolled, because the car was so old, and the tires, which I could have, and the brakes, which I could have fixed.
Yeah.
You know, anyway, I hit this pedestrian, and thank God he was a crazy person.
Yeah.
I didn't kill him.
Yeah.
But like, I hit him, and he just went like, and then hit the car. He hit the hood of the car a few times and then walked away. This is before people, you know,
before lawsuits.
You're the 80s, before people sued people.
Yeah, you're in some sort of alternate reality 1980s.
And then I figured out, you know, I said, I got to get in some acting class, and I did. There was a guy named Roy London. And at the time, the Sharon Stone was in that class.
You just found that
Jeff
class?
Jeff Goldblum. I lucked out.
Well, so, no one told you to go to that club?
No. It was like I found out through the new manager that I was getting down there about that class. And I think, who else? You know, Jim Carrey was in the class. Brad Pitt.
Really?
And none of these guys were. The only guy famous then was
Goldblum. Yeah.
And then I think Sharon Stone.
Who was the new manager?
Sharon Stone had just hit it. Yeah.
But so, and that was Bernie himself, right?
Yeah. Well, Bernie, you know, he gave me to one of his minions.
Know? But how did that all happen? I mean, so you come down. You hadn't done
Well,
your
I mean, the connection was Dave. Dennis Miller is the one who recommended me to get on the what do you call it?
Young Comedian.
Young Comedian special, and he hosted that. So
right,
and that was a Brillstein thing. So yeah. You know, you're in, kid.
Yeah. And what was it? What was Bernie like? Did you spend time with him?
Bernie was a guy like, I don't know how you. My only dealing with him was like, I didn't want to do one movie with Lorne Michaels. And he's like, I don't know how you say no to Lorne. you mean you don't know how to say no to Lorne? You just say no. I don't know how to say no to Lorne. You know, that was like, you know, his umbilical
cord. But that
cord.
Was later, right? I mean.
Yeah, that was a couple of years later. But again, you know, when you're a kid, it's just, you know, it's forever.
So you do the Young Comedian special, and then how long before SNL?
A few months.
That was it.
About 3 months after, yeah.
Now look,
I'll tell you this though. Here was the cool thing about this was I auditioned in LA at the Improv
for SNL.
Yeah, and it was like, you know, 10 comics. You know, I had to follow a guy who's like, you know, this black comic who's like super high energy.
Yeah.
He's like singing songs and dancing and it's like following Sammy Davis Jr. in Vegas. You know, it's like you don't want to.
Yeah.
But anyway, I went up there and I had a kind of fuck you attitude at that time, which was perfect for my stand up. And I had like a really kind of bit that just wasn't, what anybody else was doing at that time. It was just a little off, which was great. And not trying to make contact with the audience at all. Just kind of, so it was kind of more, you know, made a little more punk rocky than what everybody else was doing. Not very much more.
Right.
You know, I still cared about killing, but I murdered that night. And then I remember like they said, well, you know, Lorne would like to meet you tomorrow, to discuss, you know, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, and I said, well, I got a gig in San Diego. I said, I got it, you know. And so if he wants, and at that time I was like, I said, hey, if he wants to see me, he can fly me to New York.
Yeah.
And so I said, no.
Yeah.
And then I drove on the way to San Diego. I had this weird physical breakdown where, like, I started sweating from the top of my head, and it wasn't hot. And I just said, like, did I just make the biggest fuck up of my entire life? And I'm sweating and I'm perspiring, and I think I just fucked up my whole life. Anyway, but you know what? He met with a bunch of other, several other comedians. The only one who flew to New York was me.
Oh, yeah?
So I did the right call.
Yeah, you have balls, man.
So, and then they hired, and here's the best part about it, was that David Spade got hired because they said, we're a comedy writing team, even though we'd never written anything together.
Did you know each other?
Yeah, we were friends, yeah. David's one of maybe the funniest guys to hang with.
Right.
Of anybody. Like, on the grown-up set, that guy was just hilarious. You drop him in the Middle Ages, he'd be making you laugh. That guy looks like he's going to kill us all with smallpox, or, you know.
Yeah.
And so, and they just kind of, you know.
Well, what was the meeting with Lorne like? Because I've had this experience. Like, obviously, I've never been on SNL, but I've talked to plenty of people who've been on SNL.
You know,
did he make you wait?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, he flew you out there, and then you're waiting. But you don't mind waiting, because he's got, like, it's like a girl's high school yearbook at Saturday Night Live, you know? It's like, all the, there's pictures everywhere, and people sign it.
Yeah.
Dear Lorne, everything. It's like he wants to be surrounded by these memories of himself and the love that people
pretend to have
for him, you know, who are being helped by him, you know, and of course, and not seeing through any of that.
Yeah.
So, and then, you know, he surrounded himself with, like, you know, young girls and, you know, who can blame him for that?
Yeah.
And then you wait to get in, and then you get in, and I mean, he was great. I mean, first of all, you could see from his office. First of all, that guy's got the tits job of tits jobs.
Yeah.
I mean, that you know, running that show, and he was smart enough to, like, hey, I don't want, you know, people to judge me from writing, so he stopped writing pretty early on.
Right.
But if you were on that show from like I was on the 89-90 season, the end of the 89-90 season. And so if you're there before the 89-90 season, I wrote half the show. And then if you're in the room with somebody who was there in the 86 and before 1986, I wrote half the show. You know, so depending, you know, that's, making him laugh was a big deal. But the meeting was fine. I mean, the meeting was basically like, you know, I said, I'd love to be a performer on here because he said, I'm a performer. And he said, well, you know, I want to hire you as a writer. And I went, yeah, well, I'd love to perform, you know. And they, you know, well, Gary and I hired Chevy and Garrett as writers, and I think things worked out pretty well for them. And I said, I'll take it. And I said, I got some ideas. And he says, God, I'm done. You know, that was it. You know, he shooed me out of the room with the rest of you know, by one of his young underage minions.
And who was your crew? It was you and Adam and Dave? And who was on your show, your seasons?
Well, Chris Farley got hired the next year. I mean, Dave and I got hired at the end of the... And that's like, you know, Conan O'Brien was a writer there with Greg Daniels. You know, Greg Daniels went on to become, you know...
He knew Mr. Television.
Yeah.
Basically. How many years were you on there?
Like four and a half, 4 years, so 4 years
plus. That's a long run. It was a good long run.
It was good for me. It was 84 shows. I remember that.
Yeah, and Farley was fun?
Farley was great, yeah. I mean, Farley was one of those guys who was funny, you know... No matter what, if he would have been the funniest, you know, insurance salesman ever,
right,
or the funniest science teacher you ever met. Just one of those lunatics. I had a guy like him named Mike Brown up in Northern California. Mike Brown was one of those just the funniest of all the guys. This guy could just tell a story.
Yeah,
that he would tell a story about like, you know, there was a sleepover and this one guy trying to rape this one girl, and it sounds like an awful thing, but this is the '80s. You can get away with talking about he's trying to attack this girl in the middle of the night, trying to like just, you know, trying to grope her and everything like this. And it's but he had a way of just telling stories that were just great. Farley had a way of just behaving.
Yeah.
His behavior was funny and sometimes outrageous, but also he would be doing something that wasn't, you don't necessarily want him to be doing. Like we were driving out to some place in New Jersey on a Friday night, shooting something literally at midnight to 3 a.m. For a commercial parody the next day. And there was a girl in the car, and he was like putting his arm around her, you know, and farting and like, you know, trying to hit on her. And like the real genius of Saturday Night Live is a guy named Jim Downey. And he was in the car, and he just screamed at him, like, "That's not fucking funny! It's not fucking funny!" And you saw him just kind of like, just get squished down, like what must have happened to him most of his childhood, you know?
Yeah.
But you know, because some of the behavior was inappropriate, but at the same time, I'm laughing.
Yeah.
And so you know, your friends are, you know, your asshole friends, are laughing, encouraging it.
Yeah.
And he just, you know, he ate that up. But he was a lovely guy. I mean, I could say like, you know, he would come into work. And, you know, he would always be in a good mood. He'd always be guaranteed to get, you know, a few laughs every time you saw him. But he would come in and sometimes he'd have a wound. And I go, "Well, what was that?" And he'd had like 60 stitches on his right arm. "All right.
I put my arm through the window there last night. I just got a little angry at the girl. You know what I'm saying? Next thing you know, the window, somebody's got to pay. And that was the window last night." And, and I go, "My God, it's like a, you know, it's like, you know, Chechnya wound, you know, kind of thing. You know, something you see on like a war zone."
Yeah.
And, but that was just what happened, you know?
And
he's
an
extreme kind of thing.
Yeah. And you and Sandler was there too?
Yeah, Sandler came on in the fall of 90.
Yeah.
And he was just, he was a lovely kid.
Yeah.
Really lovely kid. And I just, you know, we said, "Come on, let's write something together." And
you guys remain friends.
Yeah, well, we were friends before. I mean, literally, when, like, my girl kicked me out of a place. I was living across the street from him.
In L.A.
In L.A., in North Hollywood, which is like, I remember moving into North Hollywood. This is, you know, for a cheap apartment complex, I don't hear any of my own neighbors. This is pretty cool.
Yeah.
That's because I was the only one that lived there first.
Yeah.
As soon as, the gay couple lived right above me, and I could hear them beating the crap out of each other. It's like, and then they'd have sex later, and you'd hear like, you know, they'd go, "I love you," and then even lower voice, "I love you."
And it's like, "Shut up, little man.
I got to move," you know.
Yeah, yeah.
But, and then he lived right across the street with Judd Apatow.
Uh-huh.
And then one time everything got thrown out of my, I told her I was leaving, you know, I was leaving her and then, you know, breaking up with her because I was starting to become famous. And then,
the girl you were living with in that apartment?
Yeah. And then she threw all my stuff out in the lawn, and then I went and stayed on Adam's. I said, "Adam, can I, you know, stay here for, you know, a little while?" And he said, "Yeah, absolutely." So then, but he didn't give me like a pillow, a sheet, a blanket. So, sleep right there.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't think about giving you a pillow or anything, you know.
We're comics. What do you want?
Yeah.
Your mommy.
Yeah, exactly. You know, "Can I put a sheet down for you, Robbie? You want it? You want tummy rub? Do you need some Vicks for your chest?" You know, none of that
what
stuff.
What do you expect from those
guys? I'm sitting there, you know, but.
See, like Norm, not Norm, but he came on too, right?
Yeah, Norm, man. I like the more gruff Norm. "Yeah, you know the thing, here's the thing. Mark,
He's mellowed.
Yeah, Norm is a genius. Norm's brilliant. I mean, he's a guy that was like too smart. And like as far as like for Saturday Night Live, he would do sketches. The audiences would stink, to be honest with you, because a lot of the tickets were given away. You know, you know, Lorne Michaels and the crew, they would give their tickets to friends, and a lot of the audience, sometimes you'd have a great show audience.
Yeah.
You know, a great, you know, what do you call it? Rehearsal audience.
Yeah.
And then the live show would stink.
Yeah.
Because all the tickets are given away to the friends, and all the friends of the friends of the friends.
Yeah, they're just there for a party.
They want to go to the party afterwards. Yeah. So it's like, you know, you'd have an amazing, potential, great sketch, and all of a sudden people go, where's the party? You guys going to go to the party? When's this party? What's this show going to end so we can go to the party?
Yeah.
So there's a lot of woo. And so Norm would have really funny sketches that took, I mean, that was, I'll tell you, the bottom of that show, the worst was that show, was seeing the parrot sketch with John Cleese, Michael Palin, bomb. That's how stupid American audiences can be at the bottom of it. And that was on Saturday Night Live, like, you know, that was just after I'd left. But that's how stupid the audiences can be in America.
Yeah.
And that's what was really depressing.
Right.
And so sometimes, like, Norm had a great sketch about Charles Kuralt.
Yeah.
And he played Charles Kuralt with all the, you know, the makeup, which is totally unnecessary because the audiences didn't know the hell most of them know who he was. But it was great because he used to do those things on the road.
Yeah.
Because I'm Charles Kuralt. And I'm, because he retired that week.
Yeah.
And he said, after 30 years being on the road, there are some things that will remain with me always. Mrs. Barrington's pies in Lexington, New York. And I'll remember how those cherry pies tasted and the warmth of her company. And I said, and I'll remember a certain young basketball player in Kansas City, Missouri. This little 3-year-old could hit shots and blah, blah, blah. And I'll remember the postage stamp collector in Maine. But mostly what I'll remember about the road is the sex. The sex in every town in America. And so, you know, I'm not giving the bit justice, but it was really funny. The sex with, you know, Mrs., you know, being on top of Mrs., you know, Mrs. Hurley in Sacramento, California. She liked it in every way imaginable. And, you know, so it was just a really funny, and it had a beautiful setup.
Yeah.
You know, because that's the thing about comedy. And, like, you know, it's like, you know, John Cleese, I did a bit part in a movie that he was in and that we were both in together. And you know, the things you could take the time. If you see Fish Called Wanda, there's no jokes for 15 minutes. If you see, it's all set up.
Right.
If you see Fawlty Towers,
it's a
teleplay that's 28 minutes long.
Yeah.
There is no jokes the first 5-8 minutes. It's all set up. And just America just doesn't have, it's all about the quip.
Yeah.
It's all about who's coming in and they say it's something sarcastic remark and then somebody tops their sarcastic remark with another sarcastic retort. And it's just boring. You know, and it just, and so, and I think that, you know, it's a dumbing down. But at the same time, and that's why I stopped doing stand-up because it got so boring.
Yeah.
You know, where I, by 1990, and truthfully boring for me because I wasn't being able to really write new material. Now, stand-up though now is at its apex that I think it's ever been.
Yeah.
I think there's more great comedians right now than ever in stand-up.
Yeah.
I think you got guys who are potentially, you wouldn't think they'd be great, but like a guy like Daniel Tosh, I mean, his show's funny.
Yeah.
His stand-up's terrific.
Yeah.
He really does hold up as one of the better comedians in America. I mean, I really was impressed with his stand-up. You know, Louis C.K., I think that guy is, you know, is phenomenal. He's probably America's best comic. You got a guy like maybe one of the greatest living comics of all time is Dylan Moran. So
he's in here.
Yeah, Dylan Moran is, I think that guy's, you know.
And no one knows him here.
Nobody knows him here, but he's a superstar around the world.
Oh yeah, no, he's an amazing performer.
He is really
a lot of freedom of mind and bits and
he does, you know, he really is like the Van Gogh of, I mean, I think 100 years from now, people will still be.
Do you like doing
stand-up? His bits? Yeah, I love it. You know, it's just the touring is just beating the crap out of me because, you know, Dylan is still a young guy. I think he's 41.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
I'm 49.
Yeah,
so.
But come on. I mean, no, you're, but not it's that,
like,
you're not that
but,
old.
But, like, literally, I was in Toronto the other day to do some theater in Toronto.
Yeah.
And, I mean.
You sell all right?
I flew out there. Yeah, in Canada, I sell out every show. And most of the places I do really well. Some places, less well. You know, San Francisco, ticket sales are for that, you know.
For the Cubs.
For the Cubs, Cub I'm working up there. And so, you know, I mean, but yeah, I mean, I'm enjoying it, especially when you got new material. I you know, the one thing is most people don't even know that I ever did stand up. So
it's bizarre.
Yeah, but it happens. You know, by the time,
like,
you know,
I remember your stand up more than other things.
Yeah, well thank you.
Because I'm a stand up.
But I you know, so I finally did it. I taped a special, and I don't know. It's going to probably end up on Showtime or something.
We just gave birth to a new hour.
Yeah, I did. I know, but you know, it's you know, but I it's interesting because like I have here.
You have a bag of things.
I got a bag of bits. I got like my 30 new jokes that I'm working on. A couple of them I had to burn for the new special, which means they're over with.
You want to bounce them off me?
But Bill Burr, by the way, another great comic. Yeah, yeah. Another great comic. Why that guy doesn't have a show?
It's going to happen.
Yeah.
He's building.
Yeah, that guy's just brilliant, you know. You better do it soon, though. You know, 40 is like, you know, for kids, 40 is like 80 for, you know, teenagers. And unfortunately, that's who runs the show business.
Yeah, but comics, sometimes they can...
Yeah, yeah, no, but like, yeah, it can happen. For, yeah. He's brilliant. He's going to do something.
Is that a bit?
Well, these are all just bits. Some of them less, you know, some of them just, you know, the cool thing about stand-up was very similar to Saturday Night Live, was you can just explore a bit and then get out and walk away from it.
Right.
I was never going to guy do like 10 minutes on one thing.
Yeah.
Sometimes it happens. But like, you know, it's just, you know, observations like that I really liked. That are like dirty bits that, like, I was pretty clean comic, you know, and not by choice, just because that was more interesting to me at the time. And, you know, you want to get on TV, but there was like, that was what was funny. But like some things, I just like some classic jokes, and I'm trying to do more joke oriented stuff now.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, when you do something nice for somebody and they don't acknowledge it.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, you know, lady. Yeah. That roll of toilet paper just magically appeared by itself. Okay. Maybe I shouldn't be in the ladies' restroom. You know, I mean, it's,
one liners.
Yeah, I mean, it's some jokes.
Yeah,
like Rodney would do.
Yeah,
I saw Rodney. We flew out to see Rodney. It was Chris Rock, David Spade, and Adam Sandler, and a couple other guys. And we went out and saw one of Rodney's last shows. And the last couple of years that he was performing in Vegas, he was so great. He said, "Hey, I know a lot of jokes," and he did like, you know, he said, "I do 200 jokes."
Yeah,
I mean, that was 200 jokes.
That's crazy.
In an hour, you know. And he remembered them all. I mean, it was like crazy.
Did you guys hang out with him?
Yeah. You know, so, you know, Rodney, and Quentin Tarantino was there that night. And Quentin, you know, showed up in his pajamas, which is, you know, annoying.
Why? Because Rodney,
because we're
going to
be there
his?
For 2 days. Yeah. And the guy's wearing pajamas the whole trip, you know. And so Rodney, we went up, and Rodney smokes pot, you know.
Yeah.
Rodney smoked pot. So I said, "I didn't know, you know, you smoke?"
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah.
I said, "Hey, I've been smoking every day for 30 years. That's why I'm still alive."
Yeah.
That's what he would tell you.
Yeah.
And then... And then he'd have his robe on, and he'd be open, and he just, you know, his balls and his dick would be hanging out. And you'd have to look away from that. Anyway, so he said, well, you know, and he still really cared about the act.
Yeah.
You know, he said, "Hey, you guys, what do you think of the material? What do you think? What do you guys? Was it hip?"
Yeah.
He said, "It wasn't. Was it square?"
Yeah.
That's what he said. Was it square?
Yeah.
And then Tarantino was baked, obviously. And he said, "Oh yeah, man, it was the squarest. I mean, it couldn't be any more square.
Oh.
I mean, I'm telling you, man." And you know, Rod didn't know who the hell Quentin was.
Right? Right.
"I mean, I'm telling you, man, it's absolutely square as can be." And he said, "Hey," and Rodney's like, "Who the hell's that guy? Is he serious or what?" And I had to go, "No, Rodney, he doesn't mean that.
Yeah.
You don't mean it, right? Square. No, he's saying square isn't bad."
Yeah.
"Oh yeah, no, it wasn't square at all, Rodney. No, not at all. No, you were it was hip. You were hip." You know, by then Rodney was like, "Oh God," you know, he was depressed.
Oh,
Rodney,
no.
Anything could tip Rodney.
Yeah,
that was it.
Yeah.
And he said, "You want to gamble?" He said, "Hey, listen, I'm going to lose $500 and then go to bed."
Yeah.
And so I said, "You know, what if you win?" "I know. Look at me. Do I look like a guy who wins?" I swear to God, he was the same off stage.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And so we'd go down, and then we went and played the crap table. I mean, it was like people were just, you know, Rodney was Rodney, but you know, if you're gambling, you want to get away from that guy who just had that loser thing.
Oh, he did?
The dice hated him.
Yeah.
I mean, the dice wouldn't even roll to the end. It got like about halfway and just collapsed, you know? Anyway, he lost $500 super quick. And then he looked at me and said, "What'd I tell you? I'm going to bed. I'm a loser." And that was it. And,
you gotta love that, though.
Yeah, and it was one of those great stories where it was like, you know, you're outside yourself watching yourself.
Yeah.
And you go, "This is pretty cool." And, but you know, Quentin Tarantino go, "Yeah, you're the squarest, man. You couldn't be more square." Well, just the guy who smokes too much. That's why I don't want to smoke.
How could he not understand what he was saying?
I don't know why, because I just think he was just, you know, in the mood trying to please, because Rodney's, you know, from the 30s.
Yeah.
So you want a guy like, you know.
Rodney was amazing.
Yeah, well, Rodney was a guy, the thing I loved about Rodney was like, you know, he stopped doing comedy to take care of his kids, and when his wife
died. He's selling aluminum siding. Him and Joe Ansis were selling jokes out of the back of a car for 12 years. And he was too miserable to perform, is what it was. He couldn't get over.
Yeah.
And then he reinvented himself. I read a great piece about him.
Well, but he really, what he wanted to do, though, what he said was, you know, wanted to make sure to get the kids into college.
Yeah, yeah.
When both kids are in college, he went back. But truthfully, he's one of those guys, like you were talking about, you know, Bill Burr, that it takes a while to grow into themselves.
That's right.
You know, like...
A lot of the best comics are like that.
Well, his face, I mean, he was on, in the late 60s, he was on Ed Sullivan. Mm-hmm. You see him, he just looked like a guy who was like... like the, you know, a thug who would, you know, a shark, you know, a loan shark's a thug who would go and collect the money.
Right.
He looked like he'd have a, you know, up his sleeve, he's got a bat, and boom, he drops and he's going to beat you. He just, his eyes were too dark. The dark, when the hair went gray and he softened a little bit, and that's when he became the Rodney of Rodney, but he was ready to, for that comeback, you know.
So what do you got going?
Well, in my way, in a similar way, I feel like, I feel
it's
like
it's all about the turnaround, right?
Yeah. Well, in some ways, for me, it's like I feel like I, you know, stand up has reinvigorated me.
Good.
So I feel like I can, you know, if I can just, you know, deal with the, you know, the tough schedule, that I think I can have a real, you know, resurgence as a stand up, which is great, you know, because I want to be known as a great stand up.
What about movies anymore?
Yeah, but you know, in your late 40s, like, you want to play the dad or the Twilight kid? No. Well, how many scenes is it? There's no scenes, but you're the dad. You just come by the set, say hi to the kid.
Well, he doesn't have a dad.
He doesn't have a dad. What? Well, I don't think you're doing a good job as my agent. Not getting, you know, but you have to write your own material, and then you also have to stay excited and energized. You know, you have to still want to have fun.
And you've taken some hits.
Yeah.
You know, the critics and the show.
Yeah, but that
the show went down. It doesn't, it rolls off you now or what?
Well, you have to be zen about it. I mean, I carry this thing with me. This when I was in Taiwan.
Yeah.
You know, and this
you got beads. You're wearing
Buddhism.
Beads on your wrist and around your. You got
beads. This is my protection for, against critics.
Yeah.
No, but the idea of criticism is mostly a self-reflective thing. I mean,
no, absolutely. Yeah.
Well, the idea of you know, so you have to become zen about it. At first, you have to know that there's two sides to every coin. You'll never see a one-sided coin. It's impossible. It doesn't exist.
Okay.
There's a connection to everything. Yeah. There has to be.
Yeah.
Or, you know, you'll never see a crest of a wave without a trough. You know, you'll never see a trough without a crest. There's a connection to it. You have to have both. And you're a fool to only look at one.
Right.
So you have to look at the other side. So the one side of it, the negative side, could be like, well, they hate me. They don't like my movies, blah, blah, blah. You know, and, or the other side, well, you know what? Maybe they're letting me free and I don't have to worry about pleasing them. Ever.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the other side to that. And then once you realize what it really is the difference between comedy seems to have, there's a real, just like in comedy, there's an emotional attachment to like music.
Yeah.
In the very much the same way it's with comedy. And comedy has to go to the essence of a person. And it's very self-reflective of a person's intelligence.
Yeah.
And so, when you don't, if you, like for instance, somebody asks you, are you a good cook? People go, nah, I'm all right. I don't cook anything special. Whatever. Yeah. They'll be honest about it. But if you ask somebody, do you have a good sense of humor?
Yeah.
They go, yeah, of course I do. That's a self-reflective. Of course I'm a great sense of humor.
Yeah.
But not everybody can have a finely tuned, highly intelligent sense of humor.
Right.
But everybody has to think they are. And so, you know, people, they get angry. If somebody's laughing at something else, comedy is arrogant. It's an arrogant art form. It's like, I'm going to make you laugh now. Here it comes. All right? Here it's coming. I'm going to make you laugh. Get ready for it. And so there's an arrogance to that. There's an artistry too.
Yeah.
But, and so the arrogance of it is other people laughing around you. But this guy ain't funny. What is this crap?
Yeah.
And so it's an attack on you.
Yeah. Right.
If you don't laugh at it.
Right.
If you don't like it. And so you have to attack it. You know, then again, you know, some of the criticism, you know, I think like as far as the show Rob could have been better. I thought the writing stunk. I think it could have been much better. I thought the guy that I hired didn't do as good a job as I would have loved him to. But, you know, I was also still touring at the time and he wouldn't let me in the writer's room, which is weird because I hired him years ago to get in the writer's room. And then it's like, this is a guy that I just hired, couldn't get a job and, you know, wouldn't have this job unless I hired him. So that's just one of the weird things that happens and you just got to go with it. But at the time.
So is this Zen thing new?
Yeah. But you know, the difference is you could intellectualize it, but to apply it to your life takes years.
And that's the path you're on right now.
Well, the path I've applied it to my life. But the idea is to not be a Buddha outside the world and separate from everything, like living in a monastery and just saying fuck you to the world and I'm not going to play part of your game. It's to be a Buddha in the world and not being so reactive to it.
Yeah.
So basically, is to not swing out at anything, even your own death, to not let these things get to you.
Right.
And it's all a test. I mean, I realized pretty young, even with Zen Buddhism, you realize what it is without the name of it. You know?
Right.
But you have to describe Zen Buddhism, not what it is, but what it isn't.
Right.
It's not a religion. It's not a philosophy. So what is it? Well, you know, I mean, if anybody says they know what it is, they're a fraud.
Yeah.
So, but there are some tenets to it. And then you start to realize, you know, it's just your way, it's a way of interpreting the world in a different way than as you see it. It's kind of like Freud would describe the world as a child's view of the world is an oceanic view.
Yeah.
In other words, a child, a baby, like my baby's 3 months old,
right,
can't differentiate between the mother and herself and like the world. They think when the baby closes his eyes, the world closes. There's an oceanic view.
So I still have that problem.
So it's to go through the world with that viewpoint, but from not the child's viewpoint, from an adult's.
Right.
So like a Zen Buddhist master in Japan said one time, he said, you know, I used to think there was no difference between me, my mother, and that tree, and the river, and the mountain. And through greater study, I realized there was a difference between my mother, the mountain, me, and that. And then through more study, I realized there wasn't a difference between me. And after more study, that there was a difference. And so
he said, "You're going to go places, kid. I got an English band.
You're going to open up for these bands. You're going to be huge. Let me tell you something. You're going to get quarters and bottles thrown at your head. Then you're going to realize this is a mistake.
There's no difference between you and the quarters and the bottles. But so just let it go, kid.
But at the time, you know, at the time, you think, yeah, I'll do it. He thinks it's going to work.
Yeah.
And then you realize, no.
Yeah.
This is ridiculous.
Yeah.
But that's the fun thing about show business. And what's happening now with Amazon's going to have their television online.
Mm.
And Netflix has a television show that's there, and you can watch whenever you want. So it's going to open up. So the studios, if they're not careful, are going to be like the long-distance phone companies.
Yeah.
They were a 20th century phenomenon that disappeared. And that's going to happen.
Yeah.
Unless they really branch out and start to become, you know. And right now, they've gone from 180 movies a year to 120 in the last 3 years, 2009, 2000. So who's going to pick up that slack? And then from 2012 to 2014, it's going to go down to 90. So basically, it's going to be superheroes and Twilight movies.
And whatever's on the computer.
Yeah, and so, yeah, whatever, and video games
that
become a movie. So that's it. And so somebody's going to have to pick up a slack, and they're going to have to make it for, it's an aging community, it's an aging culture, and somebody's going to have to make movies for people who want to see movies and or have the minutia of like a show on FX like Louis C.K. Enough people see him, that's enough.
Yeah.
And so it's finally going to happen. But in any time, you know, where there's a consternation or there's a kind of a redo in show business like it was in the late 60s
right,
when the old studio system collapsed, it opened up the gates to some interesting stuff. And that's what's about to happen now. And that's what I think what's interesting with stand-up is we have the complete freedom to do what we want to do on stage. And I like that. But I'd also like to get back into cinema and do a few movies. But, you know, the difference now is like I don't want to just do a movie to do a movie. I want to do a movie because I really like it and because I want to spend a year of my life on it.
Are you writing any movies?
Yeah, I'm finishing a movie that's taken me a year to write, and I'm almost done with it, and it's almost tough to say goodbye to it. And I feel like, you know when you're really writing it, when you feel like the characters are talking and you can really see it, that's, and it's emotional, that's really connecting. And that's a movie, and I'm going to do it in Spanish, and there's going to be absolutely no money in it, but it's about a TV novella, because my wife's Mexican, and so like she's opened up a whole world to me. And it's about a Mexican soap opera star, TV novella stars. They're bigger than movie stars there.
Mm-hmm.
And he's gay,
mm-hmm.
and he's got to. It's about to come out, and he has to marry some pop star, pretend to be with this pop star, to to cover up for that. And it's just a story about the two of them, and it's really nice. It's just a nice little story. That, will probably be remade in English and ruined.
Well, I look forward to that.
There's that, and I'll probably end up playing a girl again in some fucking movie in my 50s.
Well, thanks for talking to me, Rob.
It's a pleasure, man.
All right, that's our show, folks. Thank you for hanging out. I hope you enjoyed that. Again, I will be at... I will be on Chick McGee's podcast today, Off the Air, available on iTunes and also at chickmcgee.com. And I will also be at the Palace of Fine Arts on Saturday night, the 13th. There's a free show of me sort of getting, doing a little workout before my special taping, which is sold out on the 15th at Les Poissons Rouges. But there's a free show on the 14th, Sunday night at 10 p.m. at Union Hall in Brooklyn. As always, go to WTFpod.com for all your WTF Pod needs. Get on the mailing list, kick in a few shekels, buy some merch. Got a new poster up there. The Boomy Lives t-shirts and the Coop t-shirts are on their way out. So if you want those, pick those up. What else? You can go on the comment board if you must. Try to be pleasant. I don't mind arguments. I don't mind criticism. But don't be a dick. All right? How's that? Don't be a dick. What else? Oh, I just burped. That is not professional. That is not professional. Okay, are we good? Okay. Boomer lives!